Okay, so here we are with Mark and Tim from Charlatans. Lads, how are you both?
Very good.
Very well, thank you.
Very well, thank you. Just fresh from your gig in the intoxicating tea rooms, an awesome set. How did it go for you?
Yeah, it was great. It's like, well, I mean, you know, just don't really know, really. You know, it's I'm still on stage in my head. It's been that quick of getting off stage that I'm still on stage.
How long does it take for you to kind of come down from performing when you're, whether it's somewhere
like this? Never, I don't think, you know.
Oh, don't knock stuff over. This is the dangers of having an interview in such a...
you need a bigger caravan.
I do. Sorry about this. How about you?
It was good fun. I'm still, it was nice and hot. My hair's gone curly, which is always a good sign that it's been a good gig.
Now, to explain why we are sat in the caravan, obviously we're at the Tim Peake's diner. Tell everyone how this phenomenon sort of has evolved from the germ of a tweet, I understand.
Tim Peake's diner. It started with a tweet. I asked if people wanted a cup of coffee one morning, and I got, you know, more response than ever, really, from Twitter. And so people just responded and said, I'll have a flat white, and I would. It was a metaphysical diner. And then somebody said, you need a name, and suggested Tim Peake's, which, because I'd been already been saying that, you know, David Lynch is my favourite film director and all that kind of stuff. Yeah. And then someone said, oh, well, we can make some coffee for you if you want. So we did a bit of research and, you know, decided that it had to be, well, didn't need much research, but it had to be fair trade. And we wanted to give the profits to the David Lynch Foundation because we nicked the name off him, basically. So that's what happens. And now it's become this beautiful journey of a bean that helps feed Gerardo Comanche's family in Costa Rica, and then helps the DLF Foundation to teach meditation to people with like post-traumatic stress and people in people who have live in poor areas, and we think it's a good thing. So basically, we did a pop-up diner at Kendall Calling last year, and then this year we're doing a few other festivals, and we're kind of like, you know, I made a record that's very very coffee shop inspired, and Mark's helping me to play it around the country, you know, being excellent guitarist and also keeps, you know, we're writing new Charlatans music, so that kind of like keeps it all flowing.
And I imagine you're already seeing the fruits of your labour in terms of the people that you're helping, and the where the money's going.
Well, yeah, I mean, one of the greatest things that I've ever done in my life was I gave a speech about my life, which they were obviously interested. They were, well, not obviously, but they were actually interested in. To my amazement, but it was a school in East Los Angeles, and it was for very, very poor kids, and kids in a very poor area, I should say.
Yeah.
And who'd all been all kind of had tough upbringings, and had all got into drugs age 14 and stuff like that. And then the David Lynch Foundation came in and paid for everyone to do TM, and then the year later, everybody's grades just like went through the roof, and they were listening to me tell my story, and they were just like sharing their stories, and it was just a really brilliant thing. And and I think what David Lynch is doing is fantastic. He was my favourite director, but now what he's doing is even more amazing than any of his films, really, I think.
Tell us a bit more about that, the David Lynch Foundation, for those people who don't know what it's all about.
He's funded a lot of courses, for people who want to learn TM, really. And I think I did just tell you, didn't I? I don't know. Yeah.
Well, he's obviously, you know, there's some people feeling the as I say, the fruits of your hard work that are already being part.
I think, you know, he managed to, you know, to get thousands of people to learn in, you know, in South America, and you know, and he's a lot of people have come back from fighting in the war. With terrible, you know, they've seen terrible things and can't, you know, just can't live with themselves anymore, you know, after fighting, you know, in the recent wars and stuff like that, and they're finding that TM's really helping them to get through just being themselves, you know, actually to get through it all, and I think that's a really great thing. But, you know, it's for a lot of different things. It's just a really good thing, I think, so.
Tell us what's on the menu then at Tim Peake's Diner.
Ian Brownies. Actually, that's a lie. Cherry pie brownies and James brownies. Yeah, but they should have been an Ian Brownie. What else is there, Mark? Have you sampled anything? It's coffee, obviously.
It's coffee, yeah. I've not tried anything. I arrived too late. I just arrived 5 minutes before going on stage because I'm really cool. I'll be here though in the morning, and I'll be sampling from 10 or 11 o'clock onwards.
Yeah, Toast and Maze Balls, which is kind of.
Did you have some?
Yeah, we had some Toast and Maze Bars, which.
Bars?
Yeah, which is, you know, this kind of like huge amounts of calories, you know, for people who have a crash during the day and they just need a sort of like sugar lift. It's for, you know, we cater for the sugar lovers. Well, I've just had one about 5 minutes ago. not at all. They should come with a warning, but obviously they don't, because we're rule breakers. You know, we're pioneers.
Any interesting customers so far at the diner?
Yeah, Susan Vega came and I accidentally said, "Oh, Susan Vega's going to be playing in a minute." And she was just sitting out, and she said, "Okay, I will." And she did. She did a cover version of Tim's Diner, Tom's Diner. Sorry, but she called it Tim's Diner. So
fantastic, absolutely amazing. And so what next then for Tim's Diner and for you guys?
Well, tomorrow. I mean, me and Mark are going to do something tomorrow. I'm going to do a book reading from my best-selling fantasy fiction. My best-selling autobiography, and people will be swinging by, like a super extra special guest that I don't even know who they are yet, but maybe Brandon from The Killers.
Yeah. Really?
Well, I presented him an award at the NME Awards, so he owes me, I think.
Yeah, that would be well. I'll definitely be swinging by for a cup of coffee.
Why not?
Festivals, obviously, you guys must have been to too many festivals to remember. Have you got any kind of real special or surreal festival memories that really stick out for you?
No. I'm crashing now on a post gig.
Ted Denshaw Mazeballs High.
Mazeballs party. I mean, every festival is a good one. Good festival for us, isn't it? I mean, we always used to have the busiest dressing room. Everybody used to come to our dressing room. I don't know why that was, but
because we missing out if they didn't.
Yeah, people would always miss out if they didn't come to our dressing room. And you know, Mark was the greatest host, so you know, people would come by and. You know, and
it's nice that we actually did the first Isle of Wight when it got relaunched after 1970. It's nice to come back here.
Describe to me what that was like then, when the first time back.
Well, it was in its infancy then. I think it was only one day, a couple of stages, or one stage. Robert Plant was on, and it was great.
Remember once we played with. It's pretty amazing. It was on a boat in Sweden, and we played with the Dubliners and Funkadelic.
Bootsy Collins.
Yeah, Bootsy Collins. So that's quite diverse.
Yeah, absolutely.
Awesome. Well, listen, thank you very much for taking the time to have a tea and a coffee. We'll be sure to swing by. Thanks again.
I'm going to put my glasses back on now. There you go.
Cheers, guys.